Did you ever experience headaches, jaw pain, and stiffness that was so severe it's hard for you to get out of bed? What if these symptoms were warning signs for something far more serious? Today I'm going to share the story of one of my patients, Peter, a 69-year-old man that recently retired, whose symptoms puzzled doctors for a few months. And his journey to a diagnosis could help you or someone that you know to get a diagnosis sooner. When Peter joined me in our first online consultation, he was depressed, in pain, and disappointed by the recent healthcare system interaction. At 69, a few months before his symptoms started, he just retired from a successful banking career. He was finally excited to spend his golden years traveling, golfing, or enjoying his grandkids. But instead, he was now in constant pain, exhausted, and searching for answers. His story started 3 months ago. One morning, he woke up with a severe headache over his temples. It was worse than anything he ever experienced before, and he did not usually have headaches. When he touched his temple, they were very sore. And then he noticed that when he was chewing food, he started to experience pain in the jaw, and many times he had to stop chewing the food because of the pain. Every night, he started to develop a low-grade fever. He was constantly feeling sick. He was feeling exhausted, and his appetite was gone. In just a few weeks, he lost 15 pounds. Because of the jaw pain, he visited his dentist, who recommended to wear a bite guard. He tried that, but that didn't help. For his headaches, he tried ibuprofen, but it didn't help. He called his primary care physician, who gave him an antibiotic because he suspected a sinus infection. But after 2 weeks of taking antibiotics, nothing changed. The following week, Peter started to experience neck pain, shoulder pain, and severe stiffness in the upper part of his body. And he started to have trouble to dress up or undress because of the pain and stiffness in his arms. He noticed something interesting. As the day was progressing, he was feeling slightly better as a lot of movement was helpful. But the next day, the following day, he was again in pain and stiffness. And every day, he felt sicker and sicker. Sometimes his headaches were better, but they were there every single day. They never left him. He called again his primary care physician, who did order some labs. A few hours after the labs were drawn, his PCP called Peter and he said, "Peter, your markers of inflammation are very high. Your sedimentation rate is 100 and your C-reactive protein is 125. And I think you might have an infection somewhere in your body." So he sent Peter to the emergency room. For those of you who don't know, ESR or sedimentation rate and C-reactive protein are two laboratory tests that we use to measure inflammation. Now in the hospital, Peter had many more tests, including a chest x-ray, a CT of the abdomen and pelvis, and everything came back normal. So what they did, they started him on some antibiotics, they called the infectious disease specialist, and in a few days, Peter was discharged home with no infection, no diagnosis, and he was told to call a cancer doctor. "A cancer doctor?" Peter asked. He was very scared once he heard the word cancer. And then in a few other weeks, he was seen by the cancer doctor, who recommended to do even more tests, and he also did a bone marrow biopsy. Now, you can imagine how stressful this was for poor Peter. He waited 2 more weeks for the cancer doctor to call him and said, "Peter, I have good news, but I also have bad news. The good news is that you don't have cancer, but the bad news is that I don't know what you have, and you need to see a rheumatologist." And then Peter was again confused. "A rheumatologist? Why do I need to see an arthritis doctor?" Now, let me take a small step back and tell you that I'm not surprised that Peter thought that the rheumatologist is an arthritis doctor, because many people, when they hear about rheumatology or rheumatologists, they don't know that we treat a variety of diseases, and many of our diseases are actually autoimmune diseases, including arthritis. Let's go back to Peter's story. The cancer doctor explained to Peter that he might have an autoimmune disease, and that is why he will be referred to a rheumatologist. Little did he knew that getting to see a rheumatologist is quite a challenge these days. His wife called all the rheumatologists in his area, and he could not find anyone that could see Peter sooner than 6 months. And then she thought, how about if we look for a rheumatologist online? And that's how they found me, rheumatologist on call. I forgot to mention that Peter was located in Florida while I'm located in California, but I was able to see him in 1 week. As I said, when we met for the first time, Peter was so disappointed as it looked like no one is able to solve his medical mystery. He already had a lot of tests done and his symptoms pointed towards inflammation. Actually, a lot of inflammation. Now, what do I think as a rheumatologist when I see elevated markers of inflammation? First, I think about infections, but he had no evidence of infection, correct? Second, I think about cancer, but he had no evidence of cancer either. And third, I think about vasculitis. What is vasculitis? Vasculitis is an autoimmune disease affecting the blood vessels. And there are different kinds of vasculitis depending on the type of vessels that is affected. So if there is a big vessel like aorta or the big arteries of the brain, or if the inflammation will affect medium vessels or small vessels like capillaries. But these diseases are very tricky and they can affect multiple organs. As you can imagine, our body is mapped with blood vessels. Now, many patients will develop multiple symptoms from non-specific signs like low-grade fevers, decreased appetite, weight loss, or feeling very fatigued, to even more specific symptoms like rashes, like headaches, visual changes, sinus issues, kidney issues, or even hemorrhages in the lungs. And all of these signs depend on what type of vessel is affected. Now let's go back to Peter's case. Peter had developed headaches. He had pain in the jaw, pain with chewing food, fevers, night sweats, weight loss, pain in the neck, stiffness in the shoulders. And he also had, for a few times, he had blurry vision. And he actually lost his vision in one eye for a few seconds. His laboratory test showed mild anemia and a very high sedimentation rate, which was over 100, and now a C-reactive protein was 140. And all his autoimmune labs, including NA, rheumatoid factor, anti-CCP, and other types of antibodies were negative. He had no sign of infection, he had no tumor. So I suspected a vasculitis called giant cell arteritis, or GCA, which was likely accompanied by polymyalgia rheumatica. Why did I suspect that? Because he had symptoms from both. And unfortunately, these diseases, giant cell arteritis and polymyalgia rheumatica, can come together. About 10 to 15% of patients who develop polymyalgia rheumatica, they later on develop signs of giant cell arteritis. And about 20% of patients with giant cell arteritis can also have signs of polymyalgia rheumatica. And this polymyalgia rheumatica is an inflammatory type of arthritis that affects the shoulders, the neck, and also the hips. And it is common in people over 50 and 60 and can affect both women and men. But it tends to start suddenly with pain and stiffness in the shoulders and necks, and then it can involve the hips. Like Peter, patients can have severe morning stiffness in the shoulders or the pelvis area. They will have difficulties to raise their arms up, to put something on a shelf, to dress or to undress. People will also have problems to get out of the bed, to walk to the restroom, and the mornings will be tough because they will have morning stiffness for more than 45 minutes to an hour that will gradually improve with movement, like in Peter's case. And then they can have fever, weight loss, loss of appetite. They can also have headaches because, as I said, they can have associated symptoms of giant cell arteritis. The markers of inflammation can be high in patients with giant cell arteritis and polymyalgia rheumatica, but usually the markers of inflammation in polymyalgia rheumatica they're not so high like in giant cell arteritis. If polymyalgia rheumatica is painful, the giant cell arteritis is dangerous because it requires immediate intervention, especially when patients complain about visual changes like PITR, like blurry vision, spots in the eye field, or even short periods of time when they lose vision. Because the vision changes mean that the eye arteries are affected, and this is a sign of emergency. And that means that the treatment needs to be started immediately. Why? Because if it's not started immediately, the patient can lose vision in the eyes, and there is nothing that you can do after that happens. Some patients can have other arteries in the brain affected, and if they are not treated immediately, they are at risk to develop stroke. So giant cell arteritis, it is an emergency, and it needs to be treated like an emergency. So I asked Peter to start treatment that day, and he started with a very high dose of prednisone. In a few days, I coordinated with him to have an ultrasound of his temporal arteries, and that test showed that he had thickened and inflamed blood vessels. We actually discussed the diagnosis and decided that at this point in time, a temporal artery biopsy is no longer needed in his case. Yes, temporal artery biopsy is another test, but it is invasive, and in my opinion, we had enough clues to get to the correct diagnosis. In many patients, the temporal artery biopsy, it is the gold standard test to diagnose giant cell arteritis, but in Peter's case, it was no longer needed. So how is this done? A surgeon will take a small piece of the artery, he will look under the microscope, and if the blood vessel wall is inflamed, then we make the diagnosis. But in some cases, the biopsy can be negative because this disease does not affect the whole vessel. It may skip some areas. So if the biopsy is done from one of these areas, then it can be negative. But the whole other picture, the signs, the symptoms, the history of the patient, and the elevated markers of inflammation are enough to make the diagnosis. And we should initiate treatment to prevent complications. Let's talk about giant cell arteritis treatment. The cornerstone of treatment for giant cell arteritis are steroids, like prednisone. So I started Peter on a high dose, 50 milligrams per day, to quickly decrease the inflammation. And prednisone is incredibly effective because in just a few days, Peter had a dramatic improvement. His headaches vanished, his jaw pain subsided, and he could finally eat food without any problems. And his morning stiffness and pain in the neck, in the arms, was gone. While steroids work wonders, they are not the long-term solution because high doses can cause significant side effects, from weight gain to high blood pressure to increasing the sugars in your blood and even bone loss. So to help Peter avoid the long-term complications from steroids, I started him on a complex medication called tocilizumab. Tocilizumab is a biologic drug that works by targeting a protein called IL-6 or interleukin-6. And this is a key driver of inflammation in giant cell arteritis. And tocilizumab will block IL-6 and in this way will reduce inflammation. And we have studies to prove that. Accordingly to these studies published in 2016 and another study published in 2017 in New England Journal of Medicine, tocilizumab is the next best step for patients with giant cell arteritis. Adding tocilizumab with a subcutaneous injection weekly or every other week, or doing an infusion with tocilizumab combined with a 26-week taper of prednisone resulted in faster reduction of that period when patients are on this medication and resulted in a longer period of remission in patients with giant cell arteritis. And this was a game changer for people with giant cell arteritis because for many years, we have used just steroids or a replacement for steroids like methotrexate to help patients get faster off steroids. With this combination of prednisone and tocilizumab, Peter's recovery was remarkable. Within just 4 weeks, he was back to enjoying his life. He was playing golf, he was traveling, and he started to spend more time with his grandchildren. But most importantly, the treatment protected him from serious complications of giant cell arthritis, like blindness or strokes, and it protected him from long-term side effects from steroids. Now, these days, I continue to see Peter regularly, I adjust his treatment when needed, and I keep a close eye on his inflammatory markers. Now, thank you for listening to Peter's story. If you find this video helpful, share it with others and hit that subscribe button below. And now that you know how to recognize the most critical signs of giant cell arthritis, you should learn more about Primalgia Rheumatica, because if you misrecognize this sign, you will suffer unnecessarily for weeks and months, and I will discuss all of this here.